Let's kick this off, my friend. All right, folks, thank you so much for joining us. I've got to show you my t-shirt. Okay, this is a Stream Alive t-shirt. It says connect and interact and include and engage, which is kind of what we want to do with these events. Connect with people, find our like-minded tribe. And I called out a few names of folks we've interacted with, and John is absolutely one of them as well. I think it's less than a year since I met John, but he's like a lot longer. And each time we catch up, you know, I'm like a child who goes to see their favorite magician and is going to come back seeing a few more tricks. And in some cases, if the magician is kind enough, learning a few of them as well. That's kind of the sensation I get with each of them. John's, you know, accomplishments, things he does, whether it's about how many digital events he's done, the fact that he's leads the National Speaker Association for the Northwest chapter, wrote a fantastic book. You can see it there, but if you want a more 3D version than the one John is showing there, it's here on my bookshelf on engaging virtual meetings, and I think that speaks for itself. But they say a picture is worth 1,000 words, and I think a video is worth 1,000 pictures. John, maybe you should kick off with your video. I never tire of watching it.
Get ready to engage. This gentleman is the number one Amazon hot new release author of engaging virtual meetings. He can juggle 12 screens at a time. He ran a hybrid meeting in 8 languages. And now he's going to engage with you. Put your hands in the air for John Chen.
All right. Thank you so much. I saw you, Lux, Peter, Tina, Winnie. You got your hands in the air. Thank you so much. My name is John Chen. And today, here on Stream Alive stage, we're going to show you 6 ways to host more engaging live events. So, you know, one of the secrets from a live event here, too, engage people. If you want engagement, engage. Engage people right from the beginning. So let's take a moment here and let's go to... Everyone go to the chat and just open up the chat, answer a really easy question. Where are you calling in from today? Where is your body residing in today? So just chat. All right, look great. Tina says New York City, Nuria, Baltimore. Winnie, I'm going to be in Denver, Colorado, coming up soon. I'll be there this summer. So excited for that in the Denver section here. And let's see, what else is here? Peter, UK, of course, Ravi, India. Syed, too. I've got to make sure I got the pronunciation correct. I think I heard it right. Syed, welcome. Dortmund, Germany. Syed, you're going to have to let me know where in relation to Frankfurt is Dortmund, Germany. I don't know yet. I will in a second. Martin, Pinamar, Argentina. Look at this. So check out this map here, too. So we got people from all around here. Look, there's our Indian contingent is here. Let's see, wow. Oh, I have not been to China. Well, I have not been to India. I had one trip to go to India, and I did not go, and I regret that I did not go. Oh, somebody's in Japan today. Who's in it? Tina. Oh, great. Thank you. Hi, Tina. Oh, that's right. That's your earlier chat. I know you. Okay, Germany here. London. Oh, wait, look, I can look for myself. So this would be Dortmund. Dortmund is way more on the, northish side? I would guess, maybe on the westish side of Germany. All right, good. Well, I'm so glad that each of you are tuning in today. Again, that's my mission today, is to show you 6 ways to host more engaging meetings. Now, let me just take a little moment. So I'm going to take a moment to introduce myself. And a little bit later here in the show, I would love for those who might have a camera on or just a mic on. I heard somebody was trying to multitask, and I said, good luck. On this program, but we'd love to engage with some of you. But I want to first introduce myself. I want to share what those 6 things are. And then more importantly, I want to demonstrate them here, what those 6 things are and how they can help you make your next live meeting feel more engaging. One side note, too, I just returned from a 17-day 4-city road trip. And I guess 4/5 of it was in person. And these 6 tips for engagement, I can tell you, work also in person as well as virtual. So this, despite my name as engaging virtual meetings, I'm going to tell you the core word for today is engaging. And I know Lux and Tina have been studying engagement for years. And so that's what we really want to bring here. But first, let me do myself and allow myself to introduce myself to you. Again, I'm John Chen. I'm the author of a book called Engaging Virtual Meetings. How did I get here? How many of you know what geocaching is? Right? Raise a physical or digital hand. Oh my gosh, Winnie knows. Winnie, is it okay if I bring you up here with me? Is that okay? Thank you. Winnie, if you don't mind, take a moment to unmute and let me know, what is geocaching?
Yeah, it's a whole community of people who enjoy, hi Tatiana, who enjoy like going on treasure hunts, in essence. And so you get clues or you get GPS coordinates, and then you have to go and find the item. And I'm really familiar with it because I used to work in a library, and one of the books in our library was a geocache. And so lots of people would be coming in and asking, how do I find this? And it's it can be anything. Like for us, it was just a book and people would put their stamp in it. Right. Other times it's actually a physical item.
Beautiful, Winnie. And here in the United States, some people, the only clue was the Dewey Decimal System of the book. So you would have to take that Dewey Decimal System and navigate somewhere inside of the library, only using that, and find a way to make that happen. And so I met the co-founders who are here in Seattle. Now this has turned into a sport where there are over 4 million hidden containers around the world. And I was one of the first to turn it into a team and leadership event where I did about 160 around the world. Winnie, where are you calling in from? I didn't see your chat.
I'm in Denver.
Oh, that's right. Oh, you're the one in Denver. Okay, good. So hopefully we'll get a chance to, again, I'm going to be there in August if you're around. Thanks, Winnie. So in this case, I did 160 events in person around the year. And then, of course, this thing happened in March of 2020. And let me just show you what my March of 2020 looked like. 15 canceled programs. But one of my strategies when faced with uncertainty is to look at the past. All right, we already talked about the 80s, but even I think might have been before that. Does anybody know what this thing is? This is called Prodigy. Does anybody remember what this is? Oh, come on, I stumped? Really? Okay, fine. Prodigy was the first graphical-based space online. Oh, the Webinerd has a hand up. Joshua, the Webinerd, could you do me a favor and unmute?
I am so very casually sitting on my couch, but yes, my daughter used to play Prodigy quite a lot, a later iteration than you have pictured there.
Oh, okay. Well, good. Thank you so much. Joshua, where are you calling in from? I like the art behind
I'm in Solvang, California, near Santa Barbara.
Oh, I'm a UCSB. I'm a gaucho.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, go gauchos. Solvang, you have...
Go Isla Vista.
We have the sister city of Leavenworth up here that copied Solvang.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you don't know about that history?
I think I've heard of, there's a couple, Solvang's a very Christmassy facade based town. So yes, there are some others out there.
Well, welcome, Joshua. Appreciate that.
Yeah. Featured in Lifetime movies.
So Prodigy was the first graphical meeting space online 38 years ago, where, again, at a time when modems used to make noise. Now, wait, let me see. I think I actually may have this noise here. Oh, wait, listen. Anybody remember this noise? This was used to be the voice of the internet. For people who don't know what that is, this is when modems used to have to call a number and get an acoustic sound and start running. Anyways, I was here. This means that I've been meeting online for over 38 years. And then I also wrote this book. This book is called 50 Digital Team Building Games, and that came out in 2011. So for decades, we've been trying to tell people that we can do this, that we can meet online, do effective work, save the travel and expenses, and you could have dinner with your family and friends at the end of the day. But before March of 2020, everyone said, that's a great idea, John, but here's a bunch of money and you need to fly to Orlando or India or wherever it is. So, So I don't make vaccines, but I do know how to make your virtual meetings better. So I put a class on Eventbrite, an event website, and called it Virtual Team Building, and ran it to really help people around the world at a time when there was so much need. By the end of 2020, 5,000 people took this class. And my publisher called me back and they said, hey, John, do you want to write your second book? And I said, sure. And then in what I feel like is the cruelest joke that my publisher played on me, they said, hey, John, we don't know how long this coronavirus thing is going to last, but could you rush the book? Spoiler alert, all right? One of my friends got corona last week, and I wrote this book in 9 weeks, all right? 9 weeks at 60,000 words for my authors in the house. By the way, if you're an author, right, chat the name of your book. If you are an author, chat the name of your book. I expect a chat from Lux, so like right now. Okay, good. So I wrote this book. It came out in October 2020. And it hit the number one Amazon hot new release in October 2020. And now, you know, in a year, for all the business owners out there, I completely changed my business over in less than a year. I now design, produce, speak at, and MC some of the most engaging virtual, hybrid, and in-person meetings. And so with that, I would love to give you my number one speaking tip on virtual. If you want the number one speaking tip, wonderful. Welcome, Patrick. Can I borrow your blue jacket? That is an amazing blue jacket. Okay, great. So I'm going to give you my number one speaking tip for all you virtual speakers out there. Here we go. That's right. It says stand up. All right, it sounds simple. I can tell you that less than 20% of the speakers I know stand up, right? And I'll take some time standing up and sitting down, mainly so I can engage you more. But I can tell you this, right? Standing up will give you an advantage, right? Go to the chat and just do me a favor. What do you think advantages it will give you? But the key one for me is it's your physiology. When you feel different, right? You can get your audience to feel different, so you can stand up. So while you chat those things too, let me just show you what I did with the rest of my Corona vacation here. So I'll just share a little bit of how we made this happen, right? So I built a green screen that was big enough to walk around, right? And here's the real secret here, is that this is what's in front of my face right now. And somebody also asked, so this is, yeah, I have 14 screens available to me. If necessary, I actually have 7 running right now. This is also, somebody asked me, how do I play music? Let me just show you. So yes, I have a mixer here on the left-hand side. So it allows me to put in different microphones, and one of those microphones is my Spotify iPad. So I can actually do things here, like have a lot more control over the audio. If you've ever tried to mix audio on Spotify, you know it's kind of a little bit like all on or all off. But here, now I can do things like put the audio in the background. Let's have a nice conversation. And this mixing board is not more than, this one's about 150. You can get an initial one for 100. In fact, I'm going to give you a gift. In the chat now is the list of my equipment list, everything that I believe that I have tested that I believe that I can stand behind. So those are some of the things that we're going to do. Now, let's see, before we do that, let's go and do this. Okay. I want to know, since we're going to talk about engagement, on average, how engaging are your live events in the past year, where 1 is the yawn and 10 is the best? Again, 1 is a yawn, 10 is the best. So on average, how engaging are your live events? Now, a live event, again, can be virtual, it can be hybrid, it can be in person, so whatever it might be. And I would love a volunteer, somebody who might have their camera on, to help me analyze these results at the end. Do I have somebody who is analytical? If you do, you can raise your physical or your virtual hand. I need 1 volunteer. I'll wait. You got 60 minutes. It's all right.
Tina, I think you've got your hand up. I can see you've got your hand up.
I didn't.
John.
You spoke, Peter.
Peter, I love that. Peter, I want Peter to work at my nonprofit, right, Tina?
Yes, true.
Okay, well, this is good. So what result? What do you think of these results so far, Tina?
I think it's just a little bit above average, you know, because around, 86% or just above average?
And why do you think, at least, what number did you give, if you're willing to share, Tina?
I gave 6.
Oh, you did a 6. Okay. And, you know, what do you or other people have said about the live events? Here, I'll share something for me. I went and spoke at a live conference. It's called, it's like the, let's see. Oh, it's an association that really has about catering or food and experiences. And something I was really surprised, because I was one of the last breakout sessions in this conference. So I attended everything to try and scope out what was going on. And surprising enough, it felt like everybody fell back into the, let me talk for 45 minutes and then I'll have 15 minutes of Q&A at the end. And I would have rated that conference a 5 or a 4, even though it was in person. So Tina, what are you seeing from your seat?
Yeah, I think that's, you hit the spot there with, you know, people just talk, right? No one listens to what is happening. So that interaction with the audience, and the audience doesn't feel included in most of these events, especially live events. I feel the in-person events, the structure of the events, or people has just not moved on from the world of PowerPoint, and they just stuck in that world of like, I will talk throughout, but I'm not going to listen to you. So you leave the audience are always left behind. That's what I feel, yeah.
And Tina, what would have to happen for you to go from a 5 to a 6 or a 6 to a 7? One number more.
I think there are ways of getting the audience be part of your conversation, you know, in any way, whether it's in person or a hybrid or a virtual event, where you can use the ways of doing it, like how you're doing it, whereby you ask them questions and you get their responses, or you give them a tool where they feel that they'll be able to participate along with you and be in this journey, go along the same journey with you, whatever your content might be.
Well, Tina, I also want to borrow a little bit of Lex's strategy, as Syed and Winnie are just saying, where's my t-shirt? I'm going to get a t-shirt gun here on virtual and shoot out some t-shirts, because I mean, that's the other way to engage. You know, Tina, though, let me give one of the secrets that I believe that's in my course. Guess what percentage I am planning for the audience to talk during this course today?
50%.
50%. So for all of you who are presenters, let's see again, for those who are on camera or on virtual, raise your hand or virtual hand. How many of you are presenters, trainers, people who present in front of the class? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And, I thought Ryan was going to say, I'm just an attendee all the time. Thank you, Ryan. So, yeah, Angela and Heather, great. So the majority of you are presenters. So I don't know how many of you think about this, but that is one of my core strategies. And some of those who I know who are content presenters, I feel for you. And one of the other things that I want to share with you, I just spoke recently at Training Magazine, is think of yourself not as a training presenter, but as an effectiveness trainer. And what I mean by that is, it's not how much content you delivered. It's how much content they remembered and maybe actually changed their behavior on. And sometimes that's where less is more. Less is more. Okay, great. So let me share these 6 things. And then again, I really want to get a chance to meet with each of you. All right, so here we go. So I'm going to share with you a 6-step acronym. It's called ENGAGE. Every letter stands for something, and when you do something with each one of the letters, your odds of your meeting being perceived as engaging go up. Okay, the first one is this. E, engage and interact with every attendee. As you can see, we've already done that in multiple ways here. I'll reiterate my opening statement. If you want engagement, engage. The other corollary to this is this. The first 5 minutes of your meeting or training or live event are the most important, right? Do me a favor, go to the chat and just tell me why. Why are some of these, why is engaging, or why is the first 5 minutes of any live event the most important? So what I talked about this is engage and interact with every attendee. You got to have a plan. You need to have a plan to engage and interact every attendee before the end of the meeting. And again, using tools like chat, using Stream Alive, all right? Again, this is why I personally choose Stream Alive, is because for you, the virtual audience, you don't have to learn anything new, all right? You're already using the chat that you already know and love, and then with that, we can do something bonus with it, is then visualize it inside of there. And again, I use that because it lowers the bar. All right, if you can chat, you can engage. And if you can engage, we can engage in a new way. So engage and interact with every attendee. Have a plan to engage and interact with every attendee before the end of the program. Here's the next one, right? So how many of you host a meeting or produce a meeting? You're the person who makes the link. You're the person who runs the chat. You're the person who admits somebody. Go ahead and raise you again, your physical or virtual hand. Of course, Lux is, oh, good. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I believe that maybe someone I know here. Liz, do you have your own producer? No? So do you do your own production?
100%, yes.
Okay.
I work on a team of 7 people, and I'm the main events person.
There you go. And have you ever been overwhelmed as a host?
Probably, yeah. Yeah. I've been running at least one event per month for 3 years. So absolutely, the chances of feeling overwhelmed are pretty high.
Outstanding. Okay. Well, I had a friend who started a program in March of 2020, right? There was a little catalyst for doing that. Here are all the things that she did. And Liz, I just want you to share an adjective or something, a describer word of how you might feel if you did all these things. Here's all the things she did to run her own meetings. She wrote the marketing registration, set up her own Zoom room, ran her own security, kept track of engaging with every person. She recorded and streamed to Facebook Live. She showed on slide deck. She chatted attendees while presenting. She set up around the breakout room. She showed the video and chat logs after the meeting. How did she feel, Liz?
Oh my gosh, like my stomach is in knots just listening to that. That was very visceral. Get that person a helper.
Yeah, see, get that person a helper. Well, first, Liz, let me clear the knot from your stomach. Okay, will you do a deep breath with me? Ready? Inhale. And exhale. Okay, just let me know that the knot is gone. Yeah? Okay, good. Because I don't want to leave you in that state. Okay, so the antidote here from the overwhelmed host is this. N is never lead a meeting alone. Today, I'm lucky to be joined by some expert people, Lux, Tina, and Peter, who are helping out. And they are in the chat here, too. So if you have any questions about engagement, right, they can come back and engage with you immediately. They're also admitting people, right? There's lots of different things in here. So the N is never lead a meeting alone, right? If you're only on Zoom, one of my friends, Gil, he coined the term never Zoom alone. So get somebody, right? It could be, and then split off some of that role. And the key part here is because I, the presenter, now can stay totally focused on you, while somebody else can handle all those other things. And it's one of the top services that I provide is being the producer for things like conferences, summits, and masterclasses. And people lose sleep. I had a client recently who worked on a conference, and she ended up in the hospital at the end of her hybrid conference. That's how stressful it can be. I believe meeting planning or being the meeting, in charge of the meeting, like a meeting planner, especially during a production day, is one of the top 10 stressful jobs, up there with air traffic control and a few other things like that. So take that stress, right? Like, take a deep breath and give it to somebody who's an expert in it. All right. The problem is that March of 2020 made everybody the expert, saying there's no choice. You have to do it. And now there are, I think, more choices. And if people have learned, this is a great idea to never lead a meeting alone. Okay, so the next challenge that we have here is, you might have seen a few of these online. How about this? I'm too close to the camera. My internet froze. I've got way too much headroom. Oh, luckily I don't yet today. This is great. And my good friend, I have no idea how to use a green screen. So the solution for this is G. The G here stands for good looks. So good looks means that do what you can to look great here on virtual. As you can tell, this background is my office, and it's shown exactly that it's been designed for me, right? My head is designed to go here, and then I put some items of interest. I put an award that's a patent. I worked at Microsoft, worked there for 10 years, shipped 10 products, got 2 U.S. patents. Oh, that I wrote a book that says I might be an expert in something, and then I have a photo here. Let's see. I would love somebody else to come up and help me out here. If you'd like to come join me but haven't talked yet, could you please raise your hand? I love that it's 11 degrees in Dartmouth today. 11 Celsius, by the way. Anyone going to come join me? I have a very easy question for you, I promise. There we go. Oh, Syed. All right, cool. Syed, welcome. How are you? Or is it a guten Morgen, guten Nachmittag?
Guten Nachmittag, it's already 4 p.m.
Great. How do you know Lux? How do you know the stream alive, Karen?
Oh, I'm not really sure, but Lux once attended two of my workshops. And since then, we are kind of buddies and talk really frequently. And yeah.
I love to see you. Listen to Syed's voice, right? He's got the right mic. Part of looking good is sounding good. Syed, what microphone is that?
It's a Shure MV7 because I wanted to sound like a podcast guy or like James Earl Jones or something like this.
Can you do some? Do you have any James Earl Jones on you?
No, it's just my natural voice.
Here, watch. No. Here, watch. I'll give you a line, Syed. I'm going to switch.
I am your father, or this is CNN would work, maybe. This is CNN.
Yeah, try your best CNN then.
This is CNN.
Syed, I'm not your father. No! Okay. So, Syed, you care about good looks. Look, you spent a lot of time on your background. Why did you spend a lot of time in your background?
If you join like Zoom meetings or any other meetings, I think we all look the same, usually. Or you like cannot stand this fake virtual backgrounds that is just, oh, I'm I don't know, I'm on Venus or something, or I'm in the rainforest. No, you're not. So it's very obvious. And also they're not very, very well made. So if you can see like the outline, it's all pixelated and things. So then rather just having something natural, that's what I use. It's my actual background, yeah. Adding a little bit of details, which, you know, all my toys and the things I like to be surrounded by. So I feel great seeing these things, and I hopefully think people also like them when they see them in my background.
Now, are those Funko toys back there?
Yes.
Seattle. I'm literally 20 minutes from the Funko headquarters. Oh, is that what is that? Waldo, right?
Right. Where's Waldo? I have a lot of them surrounded around me.
Okay, so here we go, Syed. This is a photo in my office, right? If you can't see it clearly, this is a photograph of me tandem skydiving. You know, now, Syed, we just met and I didn't say anything and you saw that, what could you guess or surmise about me?
I don't know. You like adventures. So if I could see it clearly, maybe you like adventures, or you want to show off that you do skydiving, or you had great vacation in the last time, and I can see there's some text around it. Maybe people signed it, or I cannot actually see it, but there's maybe a story behind the skydiving. Yeah.
Yeah, there are quotes on here. There are like things about how to live life, right? Life is an adventure, don't live it at all, kind of quotes, you know? Okay, good. And so the last part here said is that if I asked you to go skydiving tomorrow, what's your answer?
No. You get to know today.
It's funny.
I'm not scared of heights. I'm scared of dying. That's my thing.
Why are you scared of dying, Syed? That's weird. So it's really funny that most people come into two categories when I ask that question, Syed. It's either heck yeah or no way. So Syed is team no way. So Syed, again, you know, let me share a story about how valuable backgrounds can be, even when virtual, right? Even when virtual. And Syed, if you have one other story about other people's backgrounds at the end of this, I'd love for you to share it. So one of my friends came around and he was interviewing for a job, and he looked up the interviewer on LinkedIn and found out that she was a Lakers fan. Now, you're in Germany, you may not know who that is, but these are the Los Angeles Lakers, right? This is some basketball. Yeah, we're talking about Kobe, right? Shaquille and all the things. So he went online and changed his background to this. This is Staples Center in LA, right? This is easily available. You can find it. In fact, Staples Centers and the LA Lakers give away backgrounds like this because they want people to, you know, further their brand. So he's in the meeting, right? He's waiting for the interviewer. The interviewer finally logs into the meeting and she just stops dead in her tracks. And she goes, okay, you got me. And now they started talking about the Lakers for 5 minutes of the 60-minute interview. And he noticed that she warmed up immediately. And in the end, he got the job. He got the job. You know, the job market is still pretty challenging for some parts. I have some of my family members who are just graduated from college and still unable to find a great full-time job. So this is how good looks can equal revenue or value or a job. Saeed, do you have any other stories you might want to share about other people's backgrounds that you remember?
I don't want to offend anybody, but let's say, just in general, the things I realize is having bookshelves. So just to, and it's always, it's your own book, of course. I don't know, you just read it, you read it daily, and it's just your book there, half open with, and you can see the title clearly. Yeah, just like Lux, but I'm talking about larger shelves, and I don't know, maybe it's always is hundreds of books. To me, it's just, I don't know, over the time or since the pandemic started, seeing all these books is, oh, I want to look very, very smart. Look, all the books I bought. I also have some books, you cannot see them, but I never read them. It's just about the title look great. The biography of Steve Jobs and other things. Never read them, but okay, they look good on camera. That's why I bought them, but I only have like 7 or 8 of them. But I just always find it funny when you see people in front of this large bookshelves, and especially when it's their own book, if you're an author. Of course, I can see yours, but it is on purpose. But sometimes it's more like, oh no, it's always there. It's just where I store my own book.
Well, here's the exercise to do. So, Saeed, I'll give a couple. I mean, Rate My Skype Room was a Twitter or X account. It's still going. And they would rate famous people's backgrounds. And books was definitely on there. I have a friend. She has all her books, and they're actually all color coordinated. All the orange books are here. All the black books are over here. The blue spine. So that's really funny. But let me do this. Tatiana, do you mind if I talk with you? Is that okay? Shake your head yes or no.
Sure.
Okay, great. So here's the activity. Watch this, Saeed. So Tatiana, where are you calling in from today?
I'm calling in from Pennsylvania.
Yeah, outstanding. Okay, do me a favor. I want you to go randomly pick a book off the shelf, randomly open the book, and read 3 sentences to Saeed.
From my books?
Yeah, your books. You can't get to my shelf. You can't get to Saeed's shelf. Maybe you can. Oh,
this is I grabbed my journal.
Okay, great. Wow, this could be amazing, people. No one in my history has ever selected their journal.
And all right, this is a quote. The definition of emerge: to appear out of or from behind something, to come out of an experience, condition, or situation, especially a difficult one, to become known or apparent. And is more of a creative type of journaling.
Oh,
so
I love that. You printed, cut out, and put patterns on it, right?
Yes, and some different things that stuck out at me. And then from Ernest Hemingway, live the full life of the mind, exhilarated by new ideas, intoxicated by the romance of the unusual.
Wow, I'm intoxicated. Let's give Tatiana a round of applause here. There we go. So, Saeed, what do you think of Tatiana's share?
This was very deep. And I know Tatiana, so I know this is not decoration in her background. She is an educator. She reads books and she needs them. So this is a total different story. You've probably read all of them, right? So they're not just there because they look great.
Outstanding. Tatiana, thank you so much for sharing so deeply with us.
My pleasure. Thank you for bringing me on the stage.
Excellent. Thank you, Saeed.
Thanks.
All right. Let's continue on here then. And the next challenge is people talking over each other. People talking over each other. So when you have a large meeting like this, one of the challenges that you have is that multiple people can start talking to each other, or you saw the challenge that I have is that nobody's talking. So the number one tip that you can have here is the A in engage. The A in engage is air traffic control. We talked about air traffic control a little earlier. And so the key piece here in air traffic control is you, either you or somebody you know, be the facilitator. try and figure out how to get one person to talk at a time until the technology allows us to all talk at the same time. And even in person, it's not really that good. Then learn how to do air traffic control. And you can also smooth through the transitions. This is why I advocate that hybrid should have both an in-person and a virtual MC. Because if there is a problem and the group gets split somehow, the virtual MC can take over and can really help along with that. Okay, the next challenge is working, right? Just working online in the early stages of COVID. And sometimes people still now, there's people trying to put out research or other things is saying that people are less effective virtually than they are in person. Although I want to refute that, Carmen Simon, if you want to follow her research, said that in a sales presentation, that actually the virtual presentation kept people's attention more and also said that more percentage-wise, more people wanted to buy or actually bought than in person or over other mediums. So you got to look for these too, because the G here says, get productive with tools. Look at all the tools you have available. You could even guess how many tools am I using here, right, to be able to do everything that we have inside of this meeting. So look and figure out how you can get productive with the tools that you have. Use all the ones inside of the platform that you have, and then begin to strike out and look for other great tools. Streamalive, right? Miro has been used by a lot of other people. There's so many features too already. I can tell people, let me just check real quick in a hand raise here. How many people have a video in their waiting room? A video in their Zoom waiting room. One, two. You're statistically more than almost all my other groups. But if you ever came to my meeting and were waiting in the waiting room, I have a 2.5 minute video that tells my history in there, so I don't have to waste 2.5 minutes when we meet. And people go, and they've come back and they go, oh, put me back in the waiting room. I want to finish the video instead of meet with me. So that's how good it can be when you get productive with virtual tools. The last challenge that I have here, how many of you have had Zoom fatigue? Just raise your hand, if you're on or off camera. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So let's see. Peter, how, let's see. What happened with you when you got, last time you got, or the first, or recall a time you did have Zoom fatigue and tell me what happened, Peter.
I think you just tune out. It's just very easy when you're not with other people in a meeting. It's just very, very easy to tune out when you're fatigued. I think back-to-back meetings on Zoom, you're not giving it your best. I think there was a study by Microsoft that showed what happens to your brain if you're doing back-to-back virtual meetings. Your brain is trying to overcompensate for all of those visual social cues that you get in person, and it just leaves you feeling absolutely exhausted by the end of it.
Yeah, thank you, Peter. And Joshua, if you don't mind, if you can unmute. Joshua says he's a former Zoom employee. He knows Zoom fatigue like few others. I would love to hear like maybe a hallmarker for that. Joshua, are you there?
Yeah, I turned on my camera too. Sorry for not having my headset on. I was just going to listen in, but you're too interactive, aren't you? Zoom fatigue really comes from, or just fatigue, video conferencing fatigue. It's not unique to Zoom by any stretch of the means. It can come from mainly from cognitive overload. So, you know, we've got too much stuff banging around in our heads. We start to tune out. That means the presentation isn't visually engaging. It isn't offering us information that we find compelling enough to stay tuned in. Or maybe we've just been run down by the last 10 meetings we were in. So it can come from a lot of sources. It can come from poor audio quality. I have tinnitus, so ringing in my ear when somebody has poor audio quality, it's really hard for me to, like if it's crackly or staticky or something, it's really hard for me to stay tuned in. So if they're not using closed caption, I'm pretty tuned out.
Wow. Joshua, what did you do at Zoom, if you don't mind me asking?
I was their first trainer and virtual event consultant, so I got to build their training program for a little while. I was I started in 2015 before we knew Zoom. So yeah, training people as kind of the voice of Zoom and the face of Zoom for a little while, and I got to build their event consulting platform.
Oh, geez. Joshua, I want to give you a personal invitation, but everyone else who's on here too, if you are passionate about virtual meetings like I am, I have a podcast called the Engaging Virtual Meetings Podcast. I know, crafty. And I would love to hear about some of your past experience. So Joshua, I'm going to share some key aspects that I found in my research for Zoom fatigue. You get to do color commentary with me today. Is that all right?
Sounds good.
Okay. So, you know that... Zoom fatigue is, everyone do this. Go to this chat and chat the maximum number of hours that you've been on virtual in one day. Chat the maximum number of hours in virtual in one day. My number, I see 8, 8, 8, 5, 6, 12, Liz, Lux 11. My number is 25 and a half. You're like, how's that possible? I actually got paid to produce somebody's birthday and she had friends around the world and we ran a Zoom meeting for 24 hours and then we said, let's just keep going. And then at 25 and a half, we're like, okay, let's call it. So I've actually run a 25 and a half meeting.
Zoom didn't automatically shut that down.
No, I know that we were waiting for it and it didn't.
They used to have a 23 hour, 59 minute limit, but I think they extended it some.
So I can tell you I validated that. I was also a software test engineer at Microsoft, so I validated that you can do more. So in one meeting, in early 2020, it was on a different platform. It was really intense, right? And then when I got up from the meeting, I went to my bedroom and I did this. And I didn't wake up, Josh, right? Is it Josh or Joshua? Which do you
prefer? Either one's fine, yeah.
Great, thank you. So Josh, I didn't wake up. I didn't wake up for until the next day. And I asked myself two questions, right? What train hit me? And why did that happen? So I've been reading all of the research around Zoom fatigue, right? The number one is that you don't have the muscle for it. So if you are not already meeting on Zoom, and I had been on Zoom since 2015, and I've been meeting virtually again for over 30 plus years, that if you had not been meeting on virtual before that and then tried to do an 8-hour day, it's gonna hurt. It's like Joshua, if I told you, you don't work out and you do CrossFit in a day, it's gonna hurt. So that's number one. Number two is this, right, Joshua? It's like, it's nothing greater, like in this amazing keynote presentation, you're totally engaged with it. They get to the main point and then, okay, well, one, Josh, I'm really messing with you. But number two is, what were the number of technical problems that people were having in any event, in virtual events? That's a question for me. Yeah, that's for you, Joshua.
Lack of preparedness.
Lack of preparedness. And how did it manifest? Like, what were some of the crazy problems that happened?
So nobody ever had these problems when they're working with me and my team, of course, ever, as we would anticipate them. So just putting that out there, and same today. Having not taken the time to get familiar with the tools and the technology that they're going to use. And I'd wager that you've got 6 to 7 applications and tools running in front of you right now. And if you didn't know any of those tools by heart at this point, the potential for you to blow it is really huge. So even if you're, just using one or two tools in your event, if you haven't taken the chance to give them a trial run and really bang them around at scale in a live type scenario, you're not informed enough to do it in front of an audience.
That's right. And then here's the last one, Joshua, right? The last one I discovered. Well, Josh, in the next 4,223 hours, I'm going to teach you all the things to make live events.
I gotta go, guys.
Okay, I can't do it anymore either. But that was it. If you don't bring the energy, right, then your audience won't bring it back either, right? Josh, tell me either your best or worst, without naming names, presenter you've ever seen on virtual.
Oh my gosh, I've been helping people with virtual since 2007. I saw you had a picture of Tony Robbins, and here my dog's getting pets right now. I saw you saw a pic, or you had a picture of Tony Robbins in one of your slides or images a little bit ago. I actually supported through GoToWebinar the first virtual event that his organization did. So that one worked out okay, but the ones that are most challenging are the ones where people refuse to turn on their video or rely on audio and slides only, and those slides aren't very compelling. They may as well be speaking like you were speaking a moment ago.
Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you, Joshua. And so Here's the last letter. The last letter here is E. Is end on a high note. End on a high note. And we got this from Product Market Research, Josh. And it says that, and if you do a 60-minute demo with any product, right, if you can architect a high note with the product, in the last 3 minutes, people were more likely to buy. And I just want to share with you, your virtual meetings are exactly the same way. In all of my programs, and it's amazing because I did Training Magazine's conference, 150 sessions. And luckily, every presenter, every trainer agreed to end on a high note. And often this is something that is forgotten. They're just like ending Q&A, right? Ending something. It's like not necessarily a high note. You can still have Q&A. I really encourage the interaction. I'm just saying, find a way to end on a high note. Find a way to end on a high note. Let's do this. I'm going to actually change this, but just run it. Everyone go to the chat, right? And chat all the different ways you can end on a high note. So Josh, for instance, you know, one of them, of course, is just recap. What's something that you learned or going to take away? Right. Josh, what are some other ways you've seen people end on a high note?
Can I exemplify ending on a low note?
Okay, sure. Go ahead.
Closing your session out with your Q&A when the last question sucked.
And you had it happen. What do you remember?
That happens all the time. They're like, okay, that's it for today, I guess. And yeah. But yeah, you should definitely have a recap. You know, this is what we covered. Thanks for your time. Here's a call to action. There always needs to be something. Yeah, throw on a tune to get people leaving with a modicum of excitement. Yeah.
Demo ChatGPT. Okay, I'm driving through a tunnel. Do a dance. Emojis everywhere. All the audience coming off a video to do a wave. Actually, that's really great. I'll share one too that I've had. Josh, was that, do you know the song Freeze Frame?
God, yeah.
So in Freeze Frame, what we do is we have people turn on and off their cameras. And every time you turn on the camera, you take a different pose. And let me tell you, the first time I did it, it was hilarious. I was like crying, laughing. It was so good. So, yeah, so let's just take a moment here. And let's see what else I have. I want to do one other piece here now, too. Thank you for all those who chatted. I just want to crowdsource some material. So let's make sure you get something valuable with your time here. And what I'd like you to do is chat me any links that you have here that are useful to you. And let's see if somebody else, Ryan or Liz, would you like to, could you come up if you like? I think, Ryan, did you shake your head yes? Are you okay with that?
Sure, I'll come up.
Okay. Ryan, what are some of the favorite resources or tools that you're using in your live meetings?
Miro, for sure. I love to use Miro in my meetings. But if you're talking about exercises, I really love the turning cameras on and off. I feel like there's a lot of room for that, for prompts. And I use Stream Alive, of course.
Yes. And what do you, how do you use cameras on and off?
I really like doing an exercise where everybody turns off their cameras and then have a question like, who here, you know, has kids, or who here lives in their hometown, or awesome. You know, just things like that. People see that, people feel seen in unique ways. And I think it also helps dispel the assumptions that people tend to make of other people by just looking at people. So it's all of a sudden you look at someone else and you're like, oh, that person has something in common with me. I didn't even expect that.
And let's do this.
It takes a group dynamic and ties it together.
Ryan, if you don't mind, I can give you a question if you like, but can you think of a question and let's go, let's just do a quick, do like two or three questions very quickly. So here, I'm going to help Ryan. Ryan, you leave your camera on, but everyone else, turn your camera off. Yeah, I said that in a virtual meeting. Turn your camera off. Turn your off. Patrick. Okay, they'll leave black boxes. That's fine. Okay, Ryan, ask the question, and then again, tell them what to do, when to turn the camera on and off. Go ahead, Ryan.
Yeah, so who here is caretaking children?
Oh, I'm not anymore. They're all out. Okay, we got three. I see Winnie, Josh, and Peter. Go ahead.
All right, another one is, who here would consider yourself a visual thinker?
Oh, for sure, that's me. Syed, funny. Liz, Lux, and our good friend Tatiana. Okay. All right, one more question.
And who here has travel plans within the next month.
That's me too. I can stay on. Okay, excellent. And now let's go ahead and first let's give Ryan a round of applause. I'm gonna demonstrate this since we already have everyone's got their camera controls on, right? So here's the deal. For the next 32 seconds, right here, I'll demonstrate. Everyone turn your camera off. One more time. Thank you so much. And you can borrow any of these initiatives, right? Ryan, you don't have some proprietary patent on these things, right? Tina, camera off. Okay, so here's what I'm going to ask you to do too. So what you want to do is you want to turn your camera off. Every time you turn your camera on, you want to be in a different new pose. Okay? So it looks like that. That's what you're going to do. Here we go. For the next 30 seconds in 3, 2, 1, go. And with one. Everyone, turn your cameras back on if you'd like, if you prefer. Thank you so much. So hopefully you see that and how easy it is to create energy in such a short amount of time, as well as engage your audience in different ways. That's the other thing to really look at is like every 6 to 10 minutes, right? You should be shifting gears, maybe modalities, maybe, you know, something else. And if you design your presentations, I think I just recently read that somebody validated the science, 9 minutes, 59 seconds, right? The human mind will tune out if you're doing exactly the same thing. So how do I know all this? Well, one of the ways is that I've been gathering feedback on every single program for this. This program has actually been delivered over 400 times, and I've presented probably over 4,000 virtual programs over the last couple of years. So one of the ways to do that is this. I just want to know who likes to win games. So do me a favor, if you have a phone or if you want to be on the chat, right, you can actually chat this lyric, chat this link here. And you can otherwise raise your phone, turn on the camera, and scan the QR code that's over here. Oh, yeah, go ahead and you can just use this QR code. Let me actually reset the QR code here in the chat. Sorry for that. I left it as my other one. Okay, so this is the new one. There you go. So this is a super quick survey. It's just going to take about 2 minutes. And I want you to tell me what engaged you in this program, right? The best reply will be published on social media right after this program. The best reply, because this tool gives me a Instagram square of some of the top comments that come from this program. Right, and I want to challenge you to tell me how to make this program even better. And if I use your idea, I will credit you in my next keynote or in every keynote that I use your idea. This idea of improving how I run this was by Kathy Armias. Kathy Armias is one of the top TED coaches, also being a coach and one of the directors at TEDx Portland, one of the largest TEDx's in the world. And so she gave me the idea about how to really improve asking for this feedback. You know, the idea is to improve this feedback came from her, and because I'm on a mission, right? And I think, Lux, hopefully I've read the group right, that I can say these words. I'm on a mission to get rid of boring-ass live meetings in the world. And I want to maximize, right, what our live and in-person time together is with that. And I can do that only with your feedback. So again, if you tell me things that you loved about this program, so I'll do more of it, and the things that I can do this better. And I will leave you with one last thought before the top of the hour. So I'll give you 60 more seconds to finish this survey. Again, chat done in the chat when you have finished the survey. So I have an idea that you're done. Thank you, Angela. I appreciate you. I think I've seen you in other programs. I'm like 99% sure. Okay, 30 more seconds. Again, chat done when you have completed the survey. By the way, you're going to get a ticket to my conference. My engaging conference will be October 1, 2, and 3. And rumor has it that Lux will be for the first time live at my conference. This is the first year we're going to be running hybrid. 150 people live in Seattle, up to 500 on Zoom, and an infinite audience in YouTube. We hope you come there. I've got three Hall of Fame speakers, not just one, but three Hall of Fame speakers who have all committed to update their programs to be the most engaging hybrid program you have ever seen. All right, thank you, Lux, Liz, and Tatiana. Okay, so let's see. I have one other last surprise here at the end. Okay, so the key here is that we have the winning wheel. I know some of you know what it is, but for those who don't, the wheel is populated by anybody who is engaged, who has chatted at least once during this program. And the name that I call, as long as it's not Tina, Lux, or Peter, I'll respin if we do that, is that you will win a VIP pass to my program. If you are in the United States, I'll ship you a package. If you are virtual, I will ship you the virtual package by email. All right, so let's see. Let's get a drum roll here. Let's find out who our winner is today. Is it Liz? Is it Robbie? The winner today is... Oh, we're going to respin. Come on, respin. Restart the spinning wheel. Three, two, give me a real winner. Oh my God, it's Josh. Give it up for Josh.
Oh my God, I never win anything.
You won something, Josh. So, Josh, you can attend my program virtually, or you could use that credit if you ever wanted to come here to Seattle. Josh, you ever been to Seattle?
I actually haven't, no.
Oh, my gosh. Well, we'd love to have you, and especially in October. That would be really be key with that. So, thank you so much for that, Josh. I will send you that info there. Let me give you a little liner notes here on the conference. There you go. So it's going to be October 1, 2, 3, the Engaging Conference. For the first time, it's going to go hybrid. Check this out. I invented this. It's called Hybrid in a Box. This allows me to roll into a room and be ready to produce hybrid in under 30 minutes. And Josh, you'll love this. We ran a program called Learnapalooza here in Seattle, where all three rooms had three cameras, three monitors. Every room was produced in a virtual way. And a PhD came back and said, this is the best hybrid event that I ever attended. So with the last 90 seconds, I want to do this. I am going to see how much recall that we have here. So let's see how much you remember of the word engage. So feel free to unmute, especially if you're not in a noisy environment, don't have a child or a dog barking. But what does the E in engage stand for? Feel free to lean into your mic and say it. What does the
engage and interact with every attendee?
Go Winnie! What does the N stand for?
Never lead a meeting alone.
Never lead a meeting alone. If Winnie's going to get all of them, she's going to clean sweep you all. What is the G?
Good looks.
Good looks. That's right. The one for Tina. Okay. What does the A stand for?
Air traffic control.
Your traffic control, get a facilitator inside of there and manage the audio channel. What's the last G stand for?
Get productive.
Get productive with tools or virtual tools. And the last one, what is the E?
End on a high note.
End on a high note. Give it to Winnie. Make sure and save the chat if you want to save the chat. It's valuable. So here are the different ways to save the chat. And most of all, I'm going to hand it back here to the one and only Lux. Thank you, Stream Alive, for hosting me today. My name is John Chen. I'm the author of Engaging Virtual Meetings, and I look forward to engaging you later on. I know some of you need to log off, so you can log off after Lux makes his announcements. But if you want to ask me questions, I will stick around for a few minutes afterwards if you want to ask something that wasn't in the class. Back to you, Lux.
John, thank you so much. Oh, gosh, that was high energy. Beautiful. Folks, thank you so much for joining us. We keep doing these events every 2 weeks. So, Peter, if you don't mind putting that link, or Tina, can you put the link again? Please join us for future events. In fact, we're going to have Saeed here in May doing an event with us as well.
I'll be there for sure. I want to see.
Yes, sir.
I want to see Syed in action.
Yeah, I mean, thanks to Syed, Amazon is making money off me because I bought one of these, and I know you've been telling me a lot about it too, John. So Syed also runs these workshops on OBS and Stream Deck, and we had some great conversations. Even better, I mean, like I said, the T-shirt, I connected with a lot of folks. Tatiana, I think we met first at Syed's workshops, and it's just nice how this kind of snowballs into meeting more and more people and finding your tribe, so to speak. So. Fellow tribesmen, tribes people, lovely to meet you all. Thank you for being here. Hope to see you in future events. If you're not already using StreamAlive, streamalive.com, and you know how to reach us, give us a shout. All the links people have shared here will be in the link library. So John, if you don't mind sending a copy of that to us, we will then send it in the post show notes once we compile the video as well. But thank you everyone, and especially John. Whoa, I can't believe we spent an hour already. This is crazy. Thank you.
Outstanding. Again, we give one more round of applause for Lux, Tina, Peter, and the team at Stream Alive. Ba, ba, ba. Again, this is your invitation. If you got to go and get some real work done, you can leave. But if you want to stay with me and partay, I'm going to stick around for a few minutes. Anybody have any questions or comments from today's program? Thank you, Patrick. I want to know where Patrick's calling in from, because that jacket is the bomb.
From London, UK, but the jacket came from somewhere through Amazon, so I have no idea where it came from.
It is beautiful. It is beautiful. Thank you so much, Patrick.
Pleasure. Thank you for doing this today.
Do you have one word to describe today?
Great.
That's very British of you. Thank you so much, Patrick. I feel like Patrick could do something like this.
Earl Grey. Hot.
It might fit his bill. I'm not sure. Anybody else? Thank you again.
I have a question for you, John.
Yeah, go, Josh.
So you've done this presentation quite a number of times, I can tell. Yeah. You've got your tools. Sorry, I get choked up about virtual events.
I'm feeling verklempt disgust amongst you.
Oh gosh, yeah, two sticks of butter. So I wonder what's it like when you're doing a presentation for the first time. Do you scale things back? Do you just practice ad nauseum before you go live that first time so that you have all the, I don't want to use the term gimmicks, but you know, in engaging, yeah. I guess gimmicks is a word. Yeah. So
tips, tools, tricks, you know, lots of techniques. So this year, Joshua, as you can tell, right, I'm doing something a little bit different. And so I'll come back. So I used to use technology. Right, I am one of the first people that's going to use a piece of technology to engage you, the chat, the poll, the other things like that, right? But then there's, do you remember the name Elizabeth Gilbert, Josh?
Actress, right?
Close, she's an author. She wrote the book Eat, Pray, Love, of which Julia Roberts, the actress, played. Yeah.
Mm.
So she gave one of the best keynotes in the last 4 years, and she used nothing except the base equipment.
Mm-hmm.
Right, a great mic, a camera, her background, and she captivated, engaged an audience just so much. 38 minutes into a 45-minute keynote, somebody said, "I feel like I'm having a one-on-one with Elizabeth Gilbert at an Italian cafe." And I looked over the participants list, 650 people were logged in, Josh. And so this year, what I'm doing is what I call TNT, which is technology and technique. I'm mashing the two together so I can do graphic-y tricks like this, which is put this inside of here, right? Or like, here, let me give an object inside of here so this makes sense, right? So now I can do things like this, like that are technical, but I'm also using the technique. And the technique is just says, right, how can I engage the audience, which is just, there's no technical trick about it. It's like, let's ask you, let's bring Josh on stage, let's talk to the audience, let's get people to chat. And so by combining the two together, I think that I found something really, really unique. And then going back to your original question, Josh, is that, yeah, I rehearse like mad because you walk through all the transitions. And then the funny part is, you know, and it's I just came from the National Speakers Association conference called Thrive. It's their winter conference. And in speaking, they have all these things like blocking, right? So blocking is like you're on stage, right? You're here. That, right, I'm going to deliver something over here. I'm actually purposely going to walk over here and do something like that. So yes, I have a run of show where everything is blocked out, ideally where it's supposed to go. And then I add improv on top of that, Josh, because I want every program to be different. I want this program to be different because you, Josh, and you, Liz, are here. And so that's what then gives the structure around it, but then allows me to respond to you, the audience, immediately. Does that help at all, Josh, in the process?
Yeah, and what's powering this? Are you using OBS or something different?
Yeah, so coming back to here to this is that just a little tour of the studio. So this is really one of my newest pieces here. This is called Elgato's Prompter. This is a teleprompter that has a video screen built into it that's by the same people who make the Stream Deck. So like right now, Joshua's in the window because he talked, and I can look right into Joshua's eyes like this and say, Joshua, right? The hoodie you have on is like one of the best hoodies I've ever seen. So, yeah, that's right. So there's six screens here. So there's a Canon SL3 behind the hair. All right, this is my phone. So if I needed to watch a back channel, if Lux and Peter and Tina and I had a back channel, they could hit me here. This is a Stream Deck. So I gave you a point here. This is 64 buttons, right? Lux has like, I think 16, but this is 16.
You're not overdoing it, John. It's fine.
You know what's funny? Watch this, Josh. You know, because you stayed here at the end, watch this. So people ask me, like, you know, I bought a Stream Deck and I didn't turn it on. You know, Lux, I'm going to bust you because your Stream Deck is not on. That Stream Deck doesn't give you any value till you turn it on and do something with it. And the easiest thing to do is pre-program text. Now watch. Watch the chat here for a second. Watch the chat. Okay, today I'm going to give you a bunch of gifts. Here's a link to all my programs. Here's my speaker checklist. Well, I'm going to give you my equipment list again. Here's a link to my conference. How about the first three chapters of my book? And then most of all, here's all my social media connections. And if you want to book a time with me, I'll meet with any of you for 30 minutes if you want help with your engagement or virtual setup. So all of those are on a push button. And they're all right. Every link is correct, right? There's no typos. So there's value with that. You know, the second thing that you can do is then have buttons. So let's say I asked a question to the group and nobody answered, like that happened earlier today. Normally I would hit this button. Anyone? Bueller? Anyone? All right. So I have other things like here's a person yesterday was named Mario, right? Oh, your name's Mario? Hold on a second. I got something for you. Here's some coins, Mario. Thanks so much for being here. So that's the next level as you do sounds. And then the last one is this, is that things like this, I push this button, I come back here to Seattle. And now, Joshua, again, I leave certain pages in a certain way every day so that I can access this stuff on the fly. Let me see. Joshua, do you like wine?
I live in wine country, but I don't drink.
Okay, Liz.
But I appreciate nice things.
Okay, Liz likes wine, so I might do something like this. Oh shoot! I still have a red wine song, and I didn't hook it up correctly. So here, let me see if I can actually fix this now on the fly. I do have the song, but it's not correctly hooked up on here. Let's see, pouring wine. Oh, yeah, the wrong MP3 is in here. Okay, so I'll have to fix it. So anyways, I can usually do red wine. Here, I'm going to do this one instead for you, Liz. This is like, I want Liz to shine bright like a diamond.
Like diamonds in the sky. Shine bright like a diamond.
So I literally have a number of songs, Josh, queued up to the right piece here. Like Josh, you know, when he was at Zoom, he really took care of people. And I have an ASCAP license in case anybody was wondering, so I can legally play copyrighted music in a Zoom meeting. I can't live stream with it, but I can play it here in this virtual meeting. So anyways, that's where you should be looking at that automation, Lux. And by the way, just plug that thing in and start with text. That's the easiest thing you can do. After you get used to that, then you add more stuff to your workflow. And Joshua is correct. The only reason that I'm at this level is that I failed faster than all y'all. All right, I have thousands of failures. The result of this equipment is the result of at least 4,000 failures and a room full of equipment that I don't use anymore because it didn't work the way I wanted it to. But now that I have the ability to do this, and then again with practice and rehearsal, it's like everything, right? It's like video games, it's a muscle memory. Now I have the ability to do these things, and again, most people aren't doing them. Here, let me just show one more, Josh. Josh, do me a favor. Can you share your favorite either song, band, or genre?
Echoes by Pink Floyd. It's only 23 minutes and 32 seconds long. Wow, that was fast.
Just for Josh.
It starts pretty slow, guys. We're going to be here a while.
This is K-S-T-R-A-M-A-L-I-B-E. We're here playing all the hits on the pandemic. That's right. We're playing you a submarine pinging. You're going to be engaged for at least 23 minutes. Here we go. Okay, so I don't remember Echoes. What album was that from?
It's off the album Metal.
So yeah, so that's one of the other pieces here, Josh, is like, again, with practice, I really feel strongly in the improv part, right? So people know, right, Josh, no, everyone knows, I did not rehearse that cue with Josh. It's my ability to respond to the environment is what I feel gives the next level of engagement. And he can give it to you too. The worst part though, Josh, is like, I asked for that, you fumble around, the moment's gone, right? If I do it 5 minutes from now, the moment's gone, right? But if I can do it in the moment, then I think we can add more to our live meetings. Good. Any other questions or comments? Liz, go ahead, Liz.
Yeah, I wanted to ask, well, first of all, thank you so much, John. This has been amazing. I took notes and I'm sending it right to my team with the recording when it comes out. So I typically work, I'm joining today from Canada, but usually I'm based in Nairobi, Kenya. And we're typically working with folks that are, first of all, across time zones, but secondly, sometimes they're only able to join with their phones. They don't have a computer. And oftentimes we're dealing with folks with low bandwidth. So having everyone on camera can really overload someone's experience, compromise their audio, their connection. And so we typically only prioritize having the speakers on camera. And I'm just wondering if you have any tips or if you have any best practices for low tech, low bandwidth environments that you would share. Yeah.
So I think one of them is I teach a class called, let me make sure I got the right one. Hold on a second. Oh, yeah. How to improve your next meeting with no additional technology. Because when I referenced that keynote from Elizabeth Gilbert, one at the end, to be honest, Josh and Liz, I was traumatized a little bit going, oh, I don't think I could ever do this, right? Run a whole 60-minute meeting where in the end, I don't change anything. Like I start here and end here and I don't do any other stuff. And then after a couple months about it going, why am I so afraid of this? Like, I got to figure this out. So what we did is that a dozen of my trainer, speaker, and facilitator friends, we tore apart that video and we found 8 things that she's doing better than all of us. And I'll give you 2 of them. And then you got to figure out how to get me to get the other 6. All right? Authenticity and storytelling. She does it better than anybody else, right? Her ability to be herself and to display authenticity and get me convinced to me, like, again, she's a highfalutin. She sold 16 million books. I have sold 20,000 and I worked my ass off, Liz, to sell 20,000. She really hit something when she hit Eat, Pray, Love. That was it was a movement, to be honest. The fact that people can still remember her name at this stage and it's so long after the book means that she made a place in our pop culture memory. And so we teach the class and we show how you can use those 8 things in that specific class where people can still feel engaged despite them being on a low bandwidth phone. Sarah Gilbert, that's right, thanks, Josh. So and look at the exercise, right? Again, I have that in my pocket as a technique, but I could have never asked for anything better than Tatiana today.
Mm-hmm.
When she pulled her journal off, I'm like, holy cow. I'm like, I'm worried for myself going, please don't overshare. Please don't overshare. but she was willing. And most of all, that she did it on her own volition and then shared something I think felt pretty deep, right? Even Syed said it.
Yeah.
Those are the moments you're looking for. And then the only other thing to do is storytelling,
mm-hmm.
which is how do you use the things that you're teaching? Oh, Peter.
Peter's assistant.
What is Peter's assistant's name?
No, this is Noah.
Hi, Noah. He's
just woken up from his nap, and his twin brother is still having his nap.
Twins! Oh my
Lucky
gosh.
You got guys.
Double. So watch
Peter suddenly got his hands full, yes.
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, here's a third bit for you. Vulnerability, which is now I can tell Peter that while I could not turn on my camera because all my kids are out of the house now, there is a time, Peter, it will come. And I can share now that my oldest son and his wife told me a couple months ago they're expecting. And that makes me the youngest. I'm the youngest in my family. I will be the first grandfather in my family. And literally tonight, my sister is flying in and my other sister will drive in and we're going to the baby shower this Saturday. And so, you know, that's the part that people want if you're willing to share, right? Again, you got to get permission. But I think when you share those things, that's what engages people, right? Like, look at Josh, right? Look at his body language. Look at Tina's body language, right? Actually, and people are matching and mirroring, and they're not even knowing that, right? Their people are connecting together unconsciously because we're sharing a moment. So that's what I want to share with you, Liz. Like, if you get the feeling that you don't have a group or a community on that call, then I invite you.
Yeah, it's you.
Hey! Then I invite you to do that. Find a way on the call, right? And find a way to get to that level. Find a way. Let's see. I think they'll respond. Like, this is a universal part. Let's see if we can wave. Everyone wave to baby one, not baby two. No? Okay, what is this one? How about this peekaboo for half a second? Ready?
No.
Oh, look, yeah, see, that worked. Right? This research tells us like these things are so universal and that you can do them. Again, and you can take lessons from that of saying what's engaging to a child is probably pretty good for us adult audiences. Anyways, thank you, Liz, for that. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah.
John, for some perspective, can you tell us about how long it takes you to set up one of your presentations?
Yeah.
You know, soup to nuts. How long do you spend on the tech and so forth?
Well, it can be as little as, well, here, I'll show you the latest one, Joshua. I did a 15-minute presentation, and I wrote the slide deck for it in 8 minutes. Because I have Copilot now running, which is like ChatGPT's Copilot is running inside of PowerPoint. It actually built the slide with all the points. I will admit to you, I did take 25 minutes to edit the slide deck to get it the way I want. But normally that slide deck would probably take me at least 3 to 4 hours, even though it's 15 minutes. Like an hour presentation can upwards the first time take up to 8 hours or more to create. And I can, the last piece though, I really want to tell you, Joshua, the secret to it is though, debrief yourself after every presentation. It took me 17 times to get this particular presentation to end on time, right? And you can only recognize what do you need to cut after running the program. You go back and you're going, well, if I have to make a decision, I'm going to cut this and I'm going to cut that. And I also build new pathways. Like today, behind the scenes, I actually spent a lot more time teaching the six things, but I felt okay about it because during the six things, I was actually demonstrating each of the points while I was doing it, which is one of my strategies. Sometimes I'll present all six if the audience is a little dead and then go back in and start to engage the audience. So I don't know which one, but I have both paths to drive down that I feel totally comfortable with all the time. So I hope that helps, Josh.
Yeah, really helpful session today. Thanks, John. Really appreciate your time. And thanks to Lux and Tina and the team for putting this on.
Outstanding. Thank you.
Good to see you, Josh. Thank you. And by the way, John, I did my unmuting using my Stream Deck. First time I'm using it in 2 months. Thank you.
You're welcome. So chat me something. Go to the chat and push a button unless you haven't programmed it yet.
I think I have something. Yeah. Whoops.
It could even just be hello world, right? To get it, take the programmer bit.
Yeah. Yep. I have had that on chat. Yes.
Yes. Now you need to add the text around here too, right? I'm giving you a gift, right? A free trial to stream it live, a way to engage. Yep. Even better here on virtual, well, anywhere now, because I've been running a hybrid. So Joshua, in my conference, the engaging conference, every speaker, if they are going to use an engagement tool, is going to use Streamalive.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Cool. Anything else, Lux? Otherwise, I'm going to hop to an interview.
John, this is fantastic. Thank you
so much.
We'll be in touch, my friend.
Yeah.
You're welcome. Thanks, everybody. And have an amazing day. And I look forward to seeing you online or in the real world somewhere. Thanks again. And Joshua, hit that interview button because I want to.
I already did.
I think it'll be hilarious. All right.
Oh, yeah. We can. I'm looking forward to talk shop a bit.
Cheers, everyone. Thank you.
All right.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks, Joshua. Take care.